This is Access Tech Live.
Now we're back on Access Tech Live, and we're going to dive into some of the stories making the headlines this week. I've got to start, Marc, with Copilot Plus PCs, the worst name ever given to a computer.
You think?
Ever. I mean, it's terrible. Come on, Microsoft, you can do better than this. But, you know, look, here's the question. Is it going to beat the MacBook? And if it does, do we care? Does it really matter? Is this true Apple's and Microsoft's? Does it make sense to compare these two? I don't know.
Let's not forget, Stephen, that when they compared them to the M3 processors and the MacBook Air, basically the entry-level M3 processor that Apple puts out there. So it's not really apples to apples in terms of what's out in the market today. I mean, they released the M4 processor, the iPad, and we're going to just start to see those appear in devices down the road. That being said, like, I've read some cool stuff from Dan Ackerman and some other people at The Verge who have been talking a lot about their hands-on experiences with these computers, and they're definitely showing that the neural processing unit, that other chip that is there just to offload the AI stuff, is performing quite well. And it's really making the whole overall experience a lot better. So I'm looking forward to it. Like, I hope to get my hands on in a couple weeks. I've asked them for the new Surface Pro to really experience that. I'm worried about compatibility, to be perfectly honest, about some apps and programs that I use, because in previous generations of Microsoft PCs that didn't have Intel processors, a lot of software didn't work out of the box. I'm assuming that's going to be a little bit different. No one's talked about it. So I'm kind of excited to check that out. I'm also excited to see what other companies are putting out, because, you know, Microsoft comes out with their Surface, and it's a great blueprint for what they're doing, but other companies tend to try to one-up them, right? They try to, okay, how can we take that to a new level? And you think of companies like Dell, Alienware, et cetera, et cetera, some of the companies that want to put up gaming computers and see how they're really taking advantage of it. That kind of excites me.
And no matter how cool it is, Lenovo will always make it look as if it's wearing a suit, which is exactly what Lenovo are all about with their machines. But, you know, you're right. Samsung, I mean, they make some really cool, sexy hardware. You know, we know that in their phones. And it's very true of their laptops as well. I remember getting hands-on with a Galaxy Book a few years ago, and I thought, what an amazing machine. But I think we should come back a little bit on this. I know we're going to talk more with Microsoft's Jason Bromit next week, and we'll talk more about that conversation. But, you know, I think for people who are asking that question, as I'm getting a lot on Double Tap, especially people writing in saying, you know, is this the time to buy a new computer? Is this the future? Should I be putting my money into this? Or is it like buying an electric car? Should I hold off and see how it all goes?
Listen, I personally think this is a first-generation device, although a lot of people are embracing it, so that it's proven technology. It's there. We've had these processors in our phones for many, many years. I would wait a bit. I wouldn't say wait a whole generation, but just wait till the reviews are really in and how people are using it the same way you're using it. It's kind of the same thing I tell people when they're just ready to buy a new computer in general. Like, is your current computer doing what you need it to do, and is it doing it well? If it's not, then yeah, it's time to upgrade, and now you have more choices than ever. But, you know, for example, I'm using an M2 MacBook Pro. It's been over a year now. I'm looking forward to an M4, and I probably will upgrade because there are benefits across the board. But hardware now these days, Stephen, it's like it's going so fast that the software is not even taking up enough percentage of the CPU and the power that's even there on the hardware side. So anything you buy, even from a couple years ago, that might be my recommendation. Buy something from last year, you know, save some dinero, save some money there, and actually get something that works perfectly fine for you. You don't need to jump on board to something new, unless, of course, you're into the gizmos and gadgets like we tend to be.
Yeah, and you're right, because, of course, there is a price attached here, and these are high-end premium machines. So, you know, you are spending, there's no low end here. Not yet, anyway. There's no low end in this. So, you know, you're buying into this, you're going to be paying some top dollar. There are cheaper options available to you that might suit your needs better. You know, consider a recent Intel Core processor, for example. Consider a decent AMD processor, Ryzen 5 or 9. You know, would be a good option to go down that route looking at. You don't have to go out and buy this today. And support for existing machines from Microsoft is going to continue for some time. So we're not at a cliff edge point here. You know, this isn't a move away immediately onto this new hardware. You should absolutely have, you know, years yet of being able to enjoy that Dell Latitude you bought in the 1990s, like I did, and rather enjoyed.
It's
a bit cost for a lot of people. And, you know, a lot of people are worried about it. They're saying, oh, you know, like you're saying, you know, what about working with other applications? What about all this? It's really important to understand this is very much day one for this. But it does seem, going by some of the early reviews, that it's going
promising.
Well.
Yeah, it's going. Mm-hmm. It seems very promising. Now, I want to segue into something. I'm a big headphone guy. I love headphones. I have way too many pairs of headphones, to be perfectly honest. I've got a new pair of Beats Solo Buds that are quite fun that I'm playing with now. There's rumors in quotey fingers of a new Beats Pill coming out in a couple of weeks. Rumors. Don't know anything about that. And you've got your hands on something that are kind of interesting, which are the Sonos Ace over-the-ear headphones. Now, Sonos, for those of you who have not heard of Sonos, they have been incredible at creating smart speakers that work together throughout your home. They've been doing this long before we had HomePods, long before we had any of these smart speakers out there. So this is their first foray into those Ace headphones, which you just held up there, the nice little white color you have. What's your experience been so far? I know you've only had them for a couple of days now, but first impressions tend to be important when it comes to these things.
Absolutely. And, you know, I am holding them up. They have this beautiful, I have to say, quite rather nice and welcome plastic finish to them on the outside, which I'm quite pleased about, because having the AirPods Max with that metal design makes them really heavy on your head.
Yeah,
too heavy. Whereas these, you don't have that problem. This isn't the beautiful white, which apparently is, you know, very easy to clean. That's something very important, apparently, if you wear makeup, not something I do. But you do have this, and part of the reason for that is because of these vegan leather inserts that they have on the inside, the little cushions that you wear over your ears. These are actually vegan leather, same for the headband at the top. So you have this beautiful, easy-to-clean device, and of course, very environmentally friendly as well. The other cool thing about these, and it's like any other Bluetooth headphones you can think of, right? You can connect a number of different devices to them. You can, of course, connect it through the Sonos app as well, and you can access all of your music through Sonos, the Sonos radio features, all of that stuff. But this actually has, Marc, physical buttons. Remember those?
What?
Not touch pads, not any of that nonsense. Actual physical buttons. And for a blind guy like me, that is exactly what you want. You want physical buttons. In this case, you've got one to pause, you've got one to play. You have an up and down, which allows you to skip forward and backward with tracks. You have a button to summon your assistant. And you've got that power button as well, which also acts as the connection for Bluetooth. It's very easy to set up through the Sonos app. Interestingly, though, Sonos did get themselves into a little bit of hot water in May because they launched a brand new app. And despite years of having a very accessible app for many blind people, especially for us to enjoy using our screen readers like VoiceOver, unfortunately, their new app was not accessible. And that is something which they were heavily criticized for, something we're actually going to be talking about a lot more over on Double Tap in the coming days. But, you know, something really interesting that happened because Sonos responded to this and said, look, you know what? We hold our hands up. We made a mistake. We screwed up and we're going to fix it. So they've been working with the community. They've invested time and money, more importantly, into getting more visually impaired people, but also disabled people generally, to review these things ahead of time, get into the beta program early so they can get these issues fixed. So a misstep, no doubt, but it seems as if they're getting it sorted, which, of course, makes products like this possible for me to play with.
Well, this is the benefit of obviously people speaking out, because when you have such a history of being such an accessible app and you come out with a pair of headphones that in just their design alone with the tactile buttons and everything is a great accessible device in itself, you know, it's light, it's comfortable, it's great. The sound quality from what I understand are quite good. I'm going to get myself a pair as well because I guess I'm obsessed with these a bit. But yeah, that's an interesting little mess up. But I know they were also trying to get it to market at a point that made sense, especially with competition, having different options out there. So it is kind of interesting. I'm looking forward to hearing, you know, your longer term review, Stephen, maybe when you get some traveling under your belt, perhaps to the dentist in a couple weeks, we will figure that out. We're not going to get into that at all. We're going to take a quick break. Coming up, Krista Couture joins us to talk about traveling with a disability and how to make sure both you and your destination and everything you're doing are accessible. So stick around. This is Access Tech Live.
There's more Access Tech Live to come. Get involved and have your say at Access Tech Live on social media. We'll be right back.